Hello guys, welcome to another video of Pressy Writing Samples. Due to some technical issue, you might not be able to see me live today, but definitely we'll continue with our session as always. So let's begin with the first sample, Pressy. This is the passage. Okay, this is how you'll get a passage in your examination. Let's read out the passage and then we'll look at the sample Pressy of this passage. Let's read the passage and understand it first. What you have to do in the exam is the same. You have to read the passage, understand it, and then you get to the Pressy writing. Students, until or unless you do not understand the passage well, it will be very difficult for you to write the desired Pressy for the examination. So let's read out. The thing above all that a teacher should endeavor to produce in his pupils, if democracy is to survive, is the kind of tolerance that brings from endeavor to understand those who are different from ourselves. Okay. It is perhaps a natural impulse to view with horror and disgust all manners and customs different from those to such we are used. And since savages put strangers to death, and those who have never traveled either physically or mentally find it difficult to tolerate the queer ways and outlandish beliefs of the nationals and other times, other seas, and other political parties. This kind of ignorant intolerance is the antithesis of civilized outlook and one of the gravest dangers to which crowded world is exposed. The educational system ought to be designed, corrected, but too much little is done in this direction at present. In every country, nationalistic feeling is encouraged and school children are taught what they were only to do ready to those of the country in which school children happens to reside. In all this, teachers are not to be blamed. They're not free to teach as they could wish. It is those who know most intimately the needs of the young. It is they who through daily contact have come to care for them. But it is not they who decided what shall be taught and what the methods of instructions are to be. So basically in this particular passage, we are talking about the current education system, that we cannot blame a teacher on how she's teaching. Basically, it is our education system which a teacher is ought to follow. Okay, a teacher cannot teach in the way she wants to teach the students because she's under certain parameters. All right, all those who are teachers may understand this thing very well. Sometimes it happens that teachers want to teach something new to children, but it's not a part of curriculum. They have to avoid it. So the fact is that teachers are not to be blamed that way. If there is a problem, there's a problem with the education system, not with the teachers, all right? So our title can be, without any doubt, it can be education system, okay? Or you can give any other title like it's not the teacher who is to be blamed. Or you can give the title current education system. Okay, like this. And how you have to write a Pressy is a teacher should make students understand how to tolerate the ones who are different from them. The students are taught what they believe easily, like the people residing in a country are inferior to them. However, it is not because of teacher. They are not free enough. It is their mentor, parents, and guardian who set instruction for them. So basically, a teacher should make the students have to tolerate the ones who are different from others. But the students are taught about different circumstances and scenarios. But due to this, it's not the teacher who has to be blamed that you are teaching the student a wrong thing, but it's not the whole sole responsibility of a teacher, but even the mentor, the parents, the guardians, they're equally responsible in creating a different mindset of a student, okay? Because they are the ones who set instructions for them, okay? Let's move ahead to another passage, okay? A keen sense of humor is a hallmark of culture. So you can understand from the first line itself that the idea of this passage is all about humor. Okay, that humor is so important. Okay, when a person can crack a joke on himself, he raises himself at one in the estimation of his friends. There are people who can throw jokes at others but never take one thrown against them. This one-way traffic is not really a high sense of humor. That means a humorous person cracks joke on himself, okay, on others. But then there are certain category of people who cracks joke on others. But when these jokes are turned towards them, they do not like it. They criticize it. So this is one-way traffic. And this one-way traffic does not come under the category of great sense of good humor. It is the essence of hamper that there should be give and takes in the process. Good humor is often the test of tolerance. A fanatic is incapable of good humor. He's tearing others to pieces, fearing of getting himself torn all the time. Good humor defeats itself if there is malice in it or is indulgent to hurt others. A joke should never hurt, otherwise it's not joke at all. Yes, good humor does not mean that while cracking a lot of jokes, you are hurting the sentiment of other person. It has to be kept in mind that one needs to be humorous, but at the same time, that humor should not hurt the feelings of the other person. Your jokes should never hurt another person's feeling or personality, because if this is the criteria, your jokes will not be considered as a joke and you will not be considered as a good humorous person. A joke makes the person who makes it, and it is the person who has to take it laugh together. That is why tolerance and culture are source of every good joke. It means if your joke is intolerable to the other person, that does not come under the category of joke. Okay, so basically this is the overall fact. So now we have understood the passage very clearly. See, students, the way I have made you explain this passage, this is the same way you have to explain the passage to yourself in the examination. Now that you have understood the passage, let's move on to the pressy writing. The title of the pressy is very simple because the passage was all about humor. So you can give any title related to humor. Like you can simply say a good sense of humor or a humorous personality like that. A great comedian is the one who can tolerate the joke on oneself. Good sense of humor cannot be one-sided. If a joke maligns anyone's character or hurts someone, it's not a good joke. A good joke should be the one which makes everyone laugh together. We got an idea about the paragraph, right? The paragraph was divided into different categories. In the beginning, it was told to us that one should tolerate joke in its own also. Joke should never be one-sided. It should never be a one-way traffic, okay? Secondly, the main thing that was discussed in the passage was that the joke should you should be tolerable towards a joke. Your jokes should not hurt the sentiment of the other person. So that's it. Let's move ahead now to the other passage. Several times in the history of the world, particular countries and cities or even small groups of people have attained a high degree of civilization. Yet none of these civilizations, important they were, have lasted, and one of the reasons why they did not least was that they were confined to a very few people. They were like oases of civilization on deserts of barbarism. Now it is no good being civilized if everybody round about you is barbarous. Or rather, it is some good, but it is very risky. So for the barbarians are always liable to break in on you and with their greatest numbers and rude vigor scatter your civilization to the winds. Now, barbarous means to be very brutal, violent. Okay. Over and over again in history, comparatively, civilized people dwelling in cities have been conquered in this way by barbarians coming down from the hills and burning and killing and destroying whatever they found in the plains. So basically, this passage is all about the history of civilizations, that when people constructed their houses, there were some violent group of peoples who were coming and destroying and killing them. Okay, title will be Civilization and Historical Period, or any other title you can write, like history, historical period and barbarians attack, like this kind of, you can make any kind of title accordingly. Okay, and now Prissy will be, in history, a high degree of civilization was not lasted for long because it was confined to a very limited number of people. Like, you know, if you talk about Babylonian, there was a place, Babylonian, and it was completely destroyed. There is no trace of that civilization. There is no trace of that place today. Right, students? So that's what it is told over here, that a high degree of civilization was not lasted, okay? It was not lasted for... They were surrounded by barbarism, being in majority, barbarians ruined the civilization, they killed and destroyed everything which they found civilized. So that was all in the passage, that in history there was a high degree of civilization, and but it did not last for a long time because there was very limited number of people. And they were continuously surrounded by barbarism, by brutal attacks, and being in majority, because these barbarians were in majority, they used to ruin the civilization and they killed and destroy everything in which they found in the civilization, not which they found civilized. Okay, let's move ahead now to the other passage, students. This passage is all about machines, okay? Machines have, in fact, become the slaves of modern life. They do more and more work that human beings do not want to do themselves. So you got an idea that the topic of this passage is related to the machinery, the technology, okay? They do more and more work which human beings do not do themselves, not want to do themselves. Think for a moment of the extent to which machines do work for you. You wake perhaps to the hoot of the siren by a machine in a neighboring factory. You wash in water brought to you by the aid of machinery, heated by machinery and placed in basins for your convenience by a machine. You eat your breakfast quickly, cooked for you by machinery. Go to school in machines made for saving leg labor. And if you are lucky to be in a modern school, you enjoy cinema where machine teaches you to listen to lessons broadcast by one of the most wonderful machines. So dependent has become men on machines that a certain writer imagines a time when machines will have acquired a will of their own and become the master of men, doomed once more to slavery. So basically, the lump sum idea of the passage is that we are totally dependent on machines. Even the man has become the slave of machine. And if you start from the day, the morning only you start to your day, you will think over it, then you will realize that how much we are dependent on machineries, that the moment we wake up, we are taking bath with the water which is heated in the heater, that water which is coming through the pipelines, and that motors and everything, that is also a machinery. Then you eat your breakfast, which is cooked on a machinery. And then you move to a school in the transport, which is also a machinery. And then when you're lucky enough to be in a modernized school, you enjoy the modernized education as well with the help of technology and machineries. So this is all about, which is being told us in the passage. And the writer once imagined a time when we'll be completely dependent on machineries, and a time will come, then we will again become a slave, okay? So the title that they have chosen over here is Machines Are Masters or Slaves. It means machines are actually our masters or our slaves. Or you can write Overdependence of Men on Machines or Machinery Are Real Dependence. These kind of titles you can pick up. The Prissy will be very simple. Machine become the slave of modern era. From morning till night, it do work for our comfort. Now here you can add one more line, that ranging from the breakfast that we eat to the time we go to school, our whole dependence is on the machinery. And the man is becoming dependent on it persistently. And if it continues, machine will become the master of the men and we will become the slave of the machinery. That's all was in the paragraph, and we have shortened it up in a Prissy format. Next passage. Among the manifold misfortunes that may befall humanity, the loss of health is one of the severest. So you got a title over here. The topic is all about the wealth. Okay, the topic is all about, sorry, health. All the joys which life cannot outweigh the sufferings of a sick. Means even if you are very happy in your life, if you are not satisfied from your health, if you are not healthy, if you are sick, even the best of the joys of the world are away from you. Give the sick man everything and leave him sufferings, and he will, that half of the world is lost to him. Lay him on a soft silken couch, he will nevertheless be under the pressure of his suffering, while the miserable beggar, blessed with health, sleeps sweetly on a hard ground. It's an example that they are given, that if you are sick, if a person is sick, no matter you give him the, like, you know, softest blanket, the silk couch, and the all the luxuries of the world, but he will be in discomfort because of her health. And a beggar, a miserable beggar with a good health, can even sleep peacefully on the road, on the ground, on a hard ground. He spend his table with dainty meals and choice drinks, and he will thrust back the hand that proffers them. And every poor man that thoroughly enjoys his dry kush, surround him with the pomp of kings. Let his chair be a throne, and his crutch a world-saving scepter. He will look with contemptuous eyes on marble, on gold, and on purple, and he would deem himself happy. Could he enjoy, even was it under a thatched roof, and health of meanest of his servants? So, overall, the point is that our real wealth is not the worldly wealth, but the health, okay? If you are sick, if you are unhealthy, even the brightest thing seems dull to you. So this was the overall idea of the passage. So the title can be Health, Blessings of the Health. You can put this title, or you can put a title like this, that health, a real blessing kind of things, okay? Yeah, the loss of health is one of the biggest misfortune that a human can suffer from. No worldly pleasure can soothe this suffering. A poor man can enjoy his sleep if he is healthy, but a sick king has to suffer sleepless and dreadful night. So the blessing of health is much cardinal than all the riches. So I hope you have got this precis and the passage, students. Let's move ahead. Yeah, this is our last passage. Let's read out. Men and women are of equal rank, but they are not identical. They can be peerless. They are peerless pair, being supplementary to one another. Each helps the other, so that without one existence of the other cannot be conceived. And therefore, it follows as a necessary corollary from these facts, anything that will impair the status of either of them will involve the equal ruin of both of them. In framing any scheme of women's education, this cardinal truth must be constantly kept in mind. Man is supreme in the outward activities of a married heir, and therefore it is in the fitness of things that he should have a greater knowledge thereof. On the other hand, noise life is entirely the sphere of women, and therefore in domestic affairs, in the upbringing, in the education of children, women ought to have more knowledge. Not that knowledge should be divided into watertight compartments, or that so that some branches of knowledge should be closed to anyone, but unless courses of instructions are based on discriminating appreciation of these principles, the fullest life of a man and woman cannot be developed. So the particular talk about is on the education of the women, that men and women are of equal rank in society, but they are not identical, they are not same, but their statuses ought to be same. But generally, it is always considered men to be supreme and dominant, and more focus is towards the men's education. However, women covers up the major sphere of life, education, and upbringing of children. So it is the right of a woman to have the education. Okay, let's read the precis which has been written over here. The topic can be the education of the women. Equal rank of men and women cannot make them same. Each is the supplement of one another. The education of men is important because it is thought that they are meant to be outward activities, to do outward activities. But women are also implied to perform domestic affairs, educate children, and what if some misfortune happened? So education of women is as important as men, because in the passage was told to us that education of the men is important because he is considered concerned with the outward activities. Okay, but when he is not like the women is concerned with domestic affairs, but she has more of responsibilities of education of children, upbringing the children, and if what happened, what if some misfortune happens in the future and she is incapable of supporting his family. So for that reason, the education of women is at most very important. So this is the pressi of the previous passage. Now, students, I hope you have understood all the pressi with their examples. Okay, so this is how you have to prepare your pressi writing for your competitive examination.